Hi, I'm Jim Logan, and I had the privilege of writing last year a book called Reclaiming Surrendered Ground. And in this book, it was geared primarily for adults, although we did mention some things about children. And we thought it might be helpful to share some insights with you. It may help you to do some specific things with children. When I got involved in spiritual warfare, it was basically dealing with adults. And I was very leery about ever working with children. I was concerned that it may be traumatic or something may happen that would be quite devastating to their personalities. So the Lord allowed me to have a lot of experience with adults before I ever was involved with children. And I'd like to share some insights that I've learned through the years in working with young children, and then the older child and the teenager. The first experience I had, I was speaking at a conference for missionaries, and a mission director was there with his family. And after the service, he came to me and asked if I would speak to his 7-year-old son that he had hearing some voices. And I said I would talk with the boy, made an appointment the next day. They were in a motorhome, and as we approached the motorhome, the boy turned and asked me, he said, "Are you good at this?" And I wanted to say, "You don't realize, but you're the very first kid I've ever dealt with," and I was really nervous. I was praying God to give me wisdom, and the last thing I wanted to do was to cause this kid to have further problems. Well, as we were going up the steps of the motorhome, God gave me a verse in 1 John 5, and it's, "I'm in Christ, and the wicked one touches me not." I shared that with a boy, and he said, "Boy, that's a good verse." And we sat down, and he actually took out a pencil and paper and wrote that verse down. Then I prayed, "Lord, how do we go into this? How do I deal with this boy?" And so the boy was sharing. I asked him, "Well, what happened? Would you share what was your experience?" And he began to tell me how he heard this voice speaking to him. And I asked the boy, and I just asked the Lord to give me some wisdom here. And I said, "Have you ever been to the zoo?" And the boy said, "Yes." And I said, "When you were at the zoo, did you ever go to the snake house?" And he said, "Yes." And I said, "You didn't go in a snake house." He said, "Yes, I did." I said, "Not really. You wouldn't go into a snake house." And I was leading him on, and finally he said, "Well, why?" And I said, "Well, don't you realize there's poisonous snakes in there?" And this 7-year-old boy looked at me and he said, "Mr. Logan, there's glass." And then he said, "Jesus is the glass, isn't he?" And I said, "Yes, Jesus is the glass." I said, "You know, if we were leaving the zoo at night and it was dark and we're walking out and the lion roared, would you be afraid?" I said, "Well, I think so." And I said, "Well, what if I told you he was behind bars?" He said, "Then I wouldn't be afraid." And we worked with this boy, realizing these voices. And then he told me that night he had in the motorhome, he saw something. And he described what he saw. And he saw it in a light fixture up in the ceiling. It lit up. He was laying on the floor. His brother was sleeping on the sort of the couch. And they didn't want to open it up, so one took turns sleeping on the floor in a sleeping bag. And he looked up, and this one particular square in the ceiling lit up, and he saw a face. He described the face to me, and I knew that this boy, this family, is a conservative family. They didn't have television in their home, so I knew he could come up with this description. And he came up with a description, and he described the eyes of what he saw and how piercing they were looking at him. And I said, "What did you do?" And he said, I told him to do what my dad told me to do. He said, "I said in the name and the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, leave and go where Jesus Christ sends you." And I said, "What happened?" And he said, "It left." Like, what did you expect? And I found that with young people, they have greater faith in the ability of the Lord to come against this and resist the enemy than a lot of adults. They just, if God said it, they believe it, and they don't have to be terrorized, and they can stand against that. And then with this boy, I said this, "You know, God must have something very special for you to do with your life that the enemy would try to frighten you or try to put these intruding thoughts in your mind." And he looked at me and he said, "Well, what do you suppose it is?" And I said, well, I don't know, you're just 7. And he said, well, I know when I'm 15. And I said, well, I'm not sure if I'll know when you're 15, but and if you keep walking with the Lord will show you exactly what he wants you to do. And then they rang the bell for the dinner meal, and the boy was running up the hill after we prayed together, and he seemed to be doing wonderful. This thing left. He wasn't hearing any more voices. It just was a one-time thing in his life. And he ran up the hill, and he said, Dad, and I thought, what's he going to tell his dad? I mean, here we're talking about spirits and all this stuff. What's he going to say? And he said, Dad, guess what? And the dad says, what, son? And he said, do you know that God has a wonderful plan for my life? And I thought, what a wonderful thing. Of all that experience, the thing that he thought about was not the demonic thing or the spooky part of it, but that God had something very special for him to do. I also did something with this boy that I learned at Child Evangelism Fellowship. And that is, I asked this boy before he left, would he be willing to dedicate his life to the Lord? And he said, yes. So I took off my belt and I made a circle on the floor. And I said, this circle represents God's will and God's purpose for your life. I said, would you be willing to step in that circle and say, God, I want to dedicate everything in this circle to you. And I want to do your will and purpose for my life as you reveal it. I said, would you want to do that? Would you want to dedicate yourself? And this boy stepped in that circle and he told the Lord that everything in that circle was his and he wanted God's will and purpose for his life. That boy, I never saw him again for years. I know the dad. I talked to him on the phone. The boy prays for me. But last year, I was in Alaska. And they came up to those meetings in Alaska. And the boy is now about 17 years of age. It's been about 10 years. And I gave him a big hug, and we were flying in an airplane looking at glaciers together. And the mission that I was ministering with flew us around, and we were looking at all the scenes from up in the air. And I asked this boy, I said, you know, you remember what happened years ago? And he said, oh, Mr. Logan, I'll never forget that. I said, it's been many, many years now. It's been 10 years. I said, have you had any demonic struggles in your life? Have you ever seen anything? Have you ever heard these voices again in your mind? And he said, Mr. Logan, I never have. Now, why, when the enemy was attacking this boy at 7 years of age, why for 10 years had he not done anything? And I think the reason is because what would be the point? Because all this boy would do was resist him and he'd have to go away anyway. Because he knew who he was in Christ. And so he was not ever bothered again. What do we do with young children? Our experience with young children is this, and we get many telephone calls where it's obvious that young children are under tremendous attack or under tremendous assault. First of all, we ask the dad, especially if he is a believer and is really concerned. We'd like the dad to pray over the child. We prefer that a child up to 8 years of age would be prayed over while they're sleeping. It is less traumatic for the child, and wonderful things can happen when the dad takes his authority in the home as the protector of the home. And we have the dad set aside a day to fast and to pray and ask God to reveal anything in their life that may hinder their ability to pray over their son or daughter and to command anything that's there that is not of God to leave. And the dads will do that. And some dads, they write, and they've spent 4 and 5 hours, and as they prayed and gave the Holy Spirit its freedom to reveal sin in their life, the Holy Spirit did just that. And they would confess that until they were a clean vessel. Because the Scripture says, if I regard iniquity in my heart, God will not hear me. And so these dads, then as the children were sleeping, would pray over them. Some of the children, there was very dramatic things that took place as they prayed over that child. Others, there was no indication of anything that really took place except the next day. And I'd like to share an illustration of a full-time Christian worker and his wife that came to me. Both of them were in bondage to the enemy. They came and they brought their 3 sons with them. They were totally and completely set free, the mom and dad. And the dad said, I know about ancestral spirits and how things can come down through the family. And he said, if I was so defeated in my life and my wife was so defeated in her life, it's hard for me to believe that my children would not come under the attack of the enemy. I certainly gave the enemy a wide open road to attack my children. And so he said, what should I do? And I said, well, you will know when the time is right to pray over the children. Well, this is a really unique experience, and I want to share it with you, their experience many years ago. That night after I left, the oldest boy, who was probably 8 or 9, came into the folks' room where they were. They hadn't gone to bed yet, and he was crying. And they said, what's wrong? And he said, I had that terrible dream again. Often, a sign of enemy attack on a child would be they have these night terrors. Now, almost every child has a nightmare, but reoccurring night terrors where they wake up screaming and you can't wake them up, but they're staring and they're afraid. And if this goes on and on, that may be a key that your child is being attacked by the enemy while they're sleeping, and he's putting these terrible thoughts in their mind and terrible dreams. Well, this boy had one of those. He came in, and the dad asked the boy a question. He said, he never asked him before. He said, what was the dream? And he said, I dreamed that everybody was dead. The whole family was dead. Everybody but me. And the dad said, I asked him a question I never asked before. Did you dream that you killed us? And he said, yes, yes. And he was sobbing and crying. The oldest boy did not know why they were there. He only knew that his mom and dad came for counseling, but knew nothing about the spiritual part of it or the enemy part of it. And so the dad just immediately sensed in his spirit that this was an enemy attack on his oldest boy. And so right then he just prayed, and in fact he commanded, he said, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I take authority over my son, and I command anything of God that's in or around him to leave him and go where Jesus Christ sends him. And the boy looked at his dad and he said, they're not all gone. The dad didn't know there was anything to be gone, for sure. And he prayed that prayer again and commanded those things to leave. And the boy said, Dad, they're all gone. The dad said, well, let's go over. The next boy was about 5.5 years of age. He went to the 5.5-year-old boy, and the boy was sound asleep in the bed. And he prayed over the boy in the bed, and he said, Mr. Logan, I wish you would have been there. My wife stood there and she saw this, but as we commanded spirits to leave our 5-year-old son, he was thrown back and forth in the bed from one side of the bed to the other. We thought he was going to be thrown on the floor, but as we just stood against it and we commanded to leave and we said, leave in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, immediately this throwing and tossing back and forth in the bed stopped. And he was still. He never woke up through this whole thing. The very next morning, the boy walked in and said to his dad and mom, guess what? And they said, what? He said, I don't hear those voices anymore. They didn't know he was hearing voices. The boy did not know his mom and dad had prayed over him. He was sound asleep. He didn't hear the voices. Their third child was a child that had a special handicap, and they were not able to, he was not able to get around, and so the mom carried him a lot, and there was a lot of bonding between this boy and the mom. As they were driving back, this boy, every time the mom would look at him, he would stiffen up. He was about 2 years of age, between 2 and 3, he would stiffen up and scream. And they kept thinking, well, we've been through a lot. Here we were at a place that was strange. Maybe this is it. And they were driving down the freeway, and he messed his diaper, and the mom turned around to change him, and he stiffened up and screamed. And the dad said, that's it. And he pulled over on the shoulder of the freeway, and he turned around, and he commanded anything that was not of God in that 2-year-old's life to leave and to go where Jesus Christ sent it. And immediately, the mom turned around, and he never stiffened or screamed again. He did it 4 or 5 times before that. I've seen this dad. In fact, he attended our conference that we have here at ICBC, the last one we had. And I asked him, I said, am I telling the story correctly? It's been a number of years now. And he said, you're telling it absolutely correctly. And I said, how are your boys doing after such sort of dramatic experiences. And he said, they're doing fine, and there's no sign of any kind of enemy involvement in their life. And so mom and dad have a very tremendous opportunity and a God-given position to take authority over any enemy involvement in the family. When a small child is having all kinds of difficulties, we have children too, three-year-old children in sexual addictions, sexual bondage. This is not normal for a little child. And it's amazing the number of calls that we get of children that are into this. You can know when a child is having this kind of a problem that it has to be some type of iniquity. Now, that iniquities are explained in the book, but there is iniquity going on in that family and that has passed on. It says the iniquities of the father are passed on to the third and fourth generation, and this has to be some type of generational thing when a child is sexual before they're sexual. Two questions that you can ask your child, and we encourage people to do that. The first question is this: do you hear anything that no one else hears? And if the child says no, that's fine. The second thing is, do you ever see anything that no one else sees? And if the child says no, that's wonderful. The third way the enemy attacks a child is to put thoughts in their mind they can't stop. They just keep going on and on and on. It's like having a Walkman on your ears, and you don't want to hear what's going on, but it just keeps going on and on. But it wouldn't be like that in a sense. The sense would be you couldn't stop that. But it's more like a thought, an intruding thought that the child cannot get rid of. And you'd be amazed of the thoughts that some of these children have as the parents talk with them when they sense something is radically wrong. Those are clear indications. I was speaking at a conference and mentioned this, and a medical doctor and his wife were leaving the conference, and the wife said, you know, Mr. Logan has told us to ask our children this question, if they ever see anything or hear things. And she said, you know, we live in a creepy house, and I'm absolutely positive that if anybody is hearing something or seeing something, it's going to be our children. And so they waited to the right time, and one day they asked the boys, the older boys, they said, do you ever hear things that no one else hears? Do you ever see things no one else sees? And the kids said, well, first of all, they said, do you ever see anything no one else sees? And the kids said, no, we never see anything. And the mother said, wow, good. They said, do you ever hear things that no one else hears? And they said, yes, we do. And the mother said, see, I told you, I knew they'd hear stuff in this creepy house. So where do you hear it? And the kids said, well, outside in the backyard. And so they said, come outside, and you'll hear the voices too. So they went out in the backyard, and down the street was a used car lot, and the kids heard this, Larry, Larry, lot one, lot one. And, you know, we can laugh at that one, but, you know, I wish every kid was hearing Larry, Larry, lot one. And the mom and dad had a big joke about that, and so at the next conference, homeschool conference, they came up and told me about it. And I wish that that you won't have to use this information that I'm sharing on this tape, but you may have to. So if you're helping a family, or if you are a family with a child up to 8 years of age, usually praying over them when they're sleeping is the best way to go. When a child is over 8 years of age, it's better to deal with that child, because at that time they're starting to give ground. They're moving into an older age, and they really definitely know right from wrong. I know a child does before that, because children can be saved at a very young age. But they may have to deal with issues in their life. There may be some issues that they're holding on to that they need to put under the authority of God's Word and under the power of the Spirit of God. And then you can pray with that child, and I would pray specifically addressing whatever the issue is. If there is a lot of lying, you may want to pray against that. That if there's enemy involvement here that is just encouraging this child to not just tell a lie occasionally, but to be a liar. Satan is the father of liars. And he is the father of lies. And when a child is deceitful that way and lying, and there's just so much of that going on, you know, is there enemy involvement in his life? There really could be. And so the older child, it's better to kind of sit down with them and to share with them, to find out what's going on in their life and have them confess that sin. And after they clean their life up, then pray against any enemy involvement in their life, that it would go where Jesus would send it. The teenagers are a unique group of people to work with. I work with a lot of teenagers. And one of the things that you have to realize in a teenager's life is this, and that is, so often mom and dad want the teenager straightened out, and we've learned something here at the counseling center, that I will not see a teenager just on the basis of the mom and dad wanting that teenager to come. I want to talk to the teenager myself over the phone, because I see young people that are brought here from other states or out of the country. And I want to be sure that that teenager is in a place where I can work with him. Many parents want me somehow to wave a Bible over that child or that young person, and he's going to be totally transformed. And we found without the teenager wanting to change, it's impossible for that teenager to change. You can't make a teenager want to get his life together. But when a teenager wants to get his life together, then walk through the very aspects of the book, from occult involvement, the area of bitterness, rebellion, a clear conscience, pride and moral failure, and any other areas that the young person wants to walk through. Teenagers want to see it in Scripture. Open the Bible. Teach them those verses. That's all in the book. And a teenager can be helped. We've seen many, many teenagers get on the other side of their problems, and these teenagers never again ever battling to the degree that they were in those areas where they had given Satan ground and areas in their life. It's important that you teach a child how to resist the enemy. And the chapter in the book on the armor can be a chapter that you may want to read and then put it down on a level of a young child. A family that I know, he is a Bible college teacher. They taught their four-year-old son spiritual warfare. They read him the children's edition of Pilgrim's Progress. It's one of his favorite books. And he really began to understand that he could resist the enemy, and he didn't have to give in to the enemy. And one day, as the mom was seeing some behavior that he was doing that was not in keeping with their desires for this child, said to the child, "I want you to go to your room, and I'm going to come in, and we're going to talk about this before I discipline you." And so the boy went in his room, and he sat down. Remember, he's only 4 years of age. And when the mom walked in, he looked at his mom, and he said, "In the name of Jesus, leave." And she said, "It's not going to work." But at least the young boy had gotten a concept of what warfare is all about. You'd be amazed at how children can gather a hold of this truth and to stand against it. We've seen marvelous things take life in children's lives. We've had a chance to watch these children go from 6 years old to 16, from an 8 or 9 or 10 year old child into their 20s, and to see them walking in victory and maintaining that victory, and then helping that child to develop a devotional life where they can get into Scripture for themselves and to internalize Scripture. This is so important in working with children of any age. Often parents think because we're teaching them truths and they know this, that this is the key. The key is not knowing. The key is for the child to internalize these truths in his life. And it's not just something they know. It becomes part of their belief system. And then when they come under attack, they can stand in truth and resist the enemy. If we can be of any further help in sending you material on how to cleanse a home, how to pray over a child, if there's anything that we here at ICBC can do to help you in ministering to a child, either someone else's or your own, please feel free to contact us, and we'd be glad to share information we have, or glad to walk you through your experience with that child.